Well, hello everyone. My name is Pastor Jason. I'm one of the pastors around here, and I am so thankful that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. We're in the midst of, actually we're concluding a series today on the book of Philemon, and we're so thankful that you have chosen to spend your time with us this morning as we look at it. We began looking at this book, and don't be intimidated when I say book. It's as you know, it's only, as many of you know, it's only 25 verses. And it is written from Paul to a dear friend named Philemon, pleading for the release or for the reconciliation with Onesimus, who is his runaway slave. But Paul is pleading that Philemon will not accept Onesimus, I'm sorry, the Philemon will not accept Onesimus back as a slave, but rather that he will accept him back as a beloved brother, because Philemon himself has been redeemed. Now, we've talked about this in a couple different areas. The first thing we talked about how complex issues in healthy communities actually bring people together rather than tear people apart. And in fact, we determined, one of the things that we noticed was that when a team or a church or a family or a community is healthy, volatile issues will actually bring people together to solve problems. But when a team, healthy community, a church, country, whatever, is unhealthy, even the slightest word will cause great disagreement and break trust. And so we talked about what it is like to live and thrive in a healthy community. We also spent some time talking about how to influence others. And we talked about the way that influence really comes when other people know that we have their best interest in mind, and that we're sacrificing as much for what we're asking for as they are. And so we look back at the people, or we're able to look back at the people that have influenced us greatly, but we're also to be an example for those that God has called us to influence, so that people do things not because they're forced to do things, but rather because they're encouraged to do things. It is leadership through influence rather than intimidation. Last week we shared about how we apply the gospel to every area of life. And basically the bottom line of last week we talked about was the fact that because you and I have been bought with a price and you and I have been redeemed, therefore we ought to forgive the transgressions of others and help them be recovered and help them become redeemed as well. And finally, this morning, we're going to look at how to face the future with confidence. There's a lot of discussion about what makes someone confident. I remember my mentor, Dr. Robinson, used to tell us that competence creates confidence. He says, if you're good at what you do, confidence will follow. But confidence will never follow you if you really don't know what you're doing, or you're really not all that good at it. And so this morning we want to talk specifically about the whole idea of confidence, how God's people can be confident, but confident to know the future is better than the present, but more than that, to have confidence while confined. How to have confidence while confined. As we know, Paul is writing this letter from a prison cell. And he is writing, not trying to get his own release, but he is actually writing, trying to get the redemption or the reconciliation of someone else. But in the midst of this confinement, Paul has a great deal of confidence. And it's the confidence that knows that the future will be better than the present. So let me read this letter to you, and then we're going to look at these last few verses that show why Paul is so confident despite his circumstances. Verse 1. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved brother and fellow worker, and Apphia, our sister, and Eurycopus, our fellow soldier, and the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of the love of the faith that you have toward the Lord Jesus and all the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the full knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. For I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. Accordingly, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you what to do what is required, yet for love's sake, I prefer to appeal to you. I, Paul, an old man, and now a prisoner for Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my child Onesimus, whose father I become in my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now indeed he is useful to you and to me. I'm sending him back to you, sending you my very heart. I would have been glad to keep him with me in order that he might serve me on your behalf during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I prefer to do nothing without your consent, in order that your goodness may not be by compulsion, but by your own accord. For this, perhaps, is why he was departed from you for a while, that you might have him back forever, no longer as a bondservant, but much more than a bondservant, as a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, receive him as you would receive me. If he has wronged you at all, or if he owes you anything, charge it to my account. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it. To say nothing of your owing me your own self. Yes, brother, I want some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. And at the same time, prepare a guest room for me, for I am hoping that through your prayers, I will be graciously given you. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greetings to you. And so do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Paul is confined, but yet even though he is confined, he is confident. The question is, where is the source of Paul's confidence from? What gives him such great confidence, even though he is in a very confined place? Well, let's look at what Paul does. The first thing we notice about Paul facing the future with confidence, Paul is able to face the future with confidence, number one, because Paul expects the best of others. Paul expects the best of others. Look with me in verse 21. Paul says this, he says, confident of your obedience, I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. That word obedience, it doesn't mean doing something that you don't want to do because you're obliged to do it. It actually has this idea of a heartfelt response that is done out of love. There are times when people will ask you to do something, and you don't want to do it, and so therefore you would do the bare minimum because you just want to get it done to fulfill the obligation so that you can move on. But there are other times that people will ask you to do something, and when they ask you to do something, you will go above and beyond. And usually it has something to do with the way that you feel about that person. There are some people that do the absolute minimum that is asked of them. And there are others that when you ask them to do something, they will go so far above and beyond. They will do the maximum possible because they genuinely love you and because they're genuinely committed to doing that which is right. Paul has this great confidence because he knows when he asks Philemon to do this, Philemon is not going to do the minimum. But Philemon is actually going to go above and beyond whatever he could imagine. There are certain people you know that are like that. There are certain people you work with that you ask them to do something and you got to check up on them 10 times to make sure it's done. And there are other people you ask them to do something and they go so far beyond what is expected. And sometimes you're even hesitant to ask them because you know that it will be done so well with so much love and so much compassion and so much excellence. As God's people, that's really what we're supposed to do. And Jim Collins wrote the book, good to great, and he studied why some organizations excel where others just kind of remain average. He basically said that the most difficult jump is to go from being good to being great, because most people are satisfied with being good. And one of his one of his theories is, I believe it's his first principle, it's called get the right people on the bus. And what Collins would argue is that to be successful, it is not important where people sit on the bus, but if you get the right people on the bus is going to go to the right location. Even if you don't know where the bus is going, if you get the right leaders and you get the right leaders around the table, you get the right people on the bus, even if you haven't determined where yet the bus is going, it will go in the right directions because you have the right people that are there. Philemon is one of those people Paul wants on the bus, because he knows Philemon is someone that will not do the minimum that it was asked, but actually, as we said before, he will go above and beyond what Paul asks him to do. I was talking with a gentleman recently that was sharing with me a trip that he had gone on, and when he went on his trip, he stayed in this really nice hotel that was known for hospitality, and while they were there, he was sharing that he had asked the waitress in the restaurant for a particular cocktail. She says, "You know what? I'm sorry." She says, "This." He said, "I noticed I was here last time. It was on the menu. It's not here anymore." And she said, "I'm sorry, it's not on the menu. But let me see what I can do." So she goes back, and she comes back with a it prepared. She said, "Listen, it's not on the menu, but they made it. They made it for you simply because you asked. And we want to go above and beyond, you know, what you required." They went out to some kind of show or some kind of play or something. They come back to the hotel that night. They walk in the room, and there was something sitting on the table in their hotel room. It was a bag with the recipe of the cocktail stapled to the front of it, and all the ingredients for the cocktail had been purchased from local stores and put in a bag and placed on the table of the room that they were staying in. And she basically had this attitude of, "I could easily get by with telling them, 'No, we don't have it. Let me recommend something else to you.'" But she went and had it made, but more than that, went to all these stores, got all the stuff, and then had it put in his room. Why? Because the whole idea is she was not thinking what is the minimum she could do, but actually what is the maximum. We see people like that in the family of God, don't we? We ask ourselves what is the most that we could do, not what is the least that we could do. And so Paul knows here that Philemon is the type of person that does the most that he can do, the best that he can do, not the minimum amount. And that gives Paul great, great confidence. The second reason Paul has great confidence is because Paul is able to anticipate the presence of others. Paul is able to anticipate the presence of others. Let me show you how he words it here. He says, "Confident of your obedience, I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. At the same time, prepare a guest room for me, for I was hoping that through your prayers I will graciously be given to you." And when I first read this, I thought that Paul was using a little bit of intimidation there. I thought that Paul was saying, I want you to release Onesimus. Oh yeah, and by the way, I'm going to come check up on you. I don't think that's what Paul's doing here. I think Paul is confidently saying that, you know what, I'm going to come and I'm going to catch you doing something right. I'm going to catch you doing something good. But more than that, it is the relationship that is as important as what I'm asking you to do. And so notice he says here, he asked Philemon to pray for him that he will be released, and that he will not only be released, but to prepare the room so that Paul is ready. So the room is ready when Paul gets there. He wants Philemon to begin making plans for them to be reunited. Now, why is Paul able to do that? Why is he able to ask that? He's able to ask that because, watch this, he knows that he is not going to be confined in the situation that he's in forever. Yes, Paul is in prison. Yes, Onesimus is there. Yes, Paul has been falsely accused. Yes, Paul is suffering for the gospel. Yes, Paul is a prisoner of Jesus Christ. But Paul knows that the confinement that he has is not where he will be at forever. He has this great confidence and knowledge that someday things are going to be better than they are right now. And that confidence, it just bleeds through this letter. Get the room ready for me, for I am coming home soon. So many times it seems like that the circumstances that we're in right now, we're going to be in for the rest of our lives. It's even though we know logically it's not going to be that way. Last week it was the coldest week of the year so far. It was 15 degrees, the average 15 degrees below what it normally is. It's just bitterly cold, and during seasons like that, we can feel like it's going to be bitterly cold forever. And then the next thing we know is that the snow turns to rain, and all of a sudden temperatures are much different. What you're going through right now, you won't be going through forever. The pain that you have right now, you won't have for eternity. The hurt that you may be suffering right now, it won't be with you forever. There will be a time that you will be healed from it, that you will feel better, that you'll be able to move forward, that you won't be defined by whatever the confinement is. Whether it's the confinement of being trapped inside in January in the Midwest, or whether it's feeling like you really can't move on with your life because of certain circumstances around you. There'll be a time that you won't be confined the way that you are right now. And so therefore we recognize that we can celebrate the presence of others. I was reading this week about the history of the foundation of the AME Church. And many of you know the account, but the founder of that movement was Richard Allen, and Richard Allen was a former slave born in 1760 in Dover, Delaware, and he secured his own freedom, and one day around 1790 he and another gentleman by the name of Absalom Jones, a minister, Absalom Jones, they were kneeling at the altar at St. George's Methodist Church in Philadelphia. And as they were kneeling, they were removed from the sanctuary as they were praying. They were removed from the sanctuary as they were praying, and they were kicked out of the church. Eventually, when Richard Allen basically made the statement that, you know what, the time of the prayer is over, and you will no longer ever have to be plagued with us in the church. But the interesting thing is, when Richard Allen started the AME denomination, the African Methodist Episcopal denomination, they say what's so transcending about that story is that is not the fact that Allen was excluded. What's so wonderful about that story is that Allen created and found a space because he knew that the future would be greater than the past. That what Allen basically did, that he had this resilience, and the resilience was greater than the frustration. And because of that, the future is greater than the past. When we accept and anticipate the presence of others, we're reminded that the future is better than the present. And so Paul can say, prepare a room for me, for I'm on my way. Well, there's a final thing, and that is that we're able to appreciate the contributions of others. When Paul writes this letter, he um, every word that Paul writes is significant. Whether it is the request to Philemon, whether it is the introduction, whether it's him defining himself as a prisoner of Christ Jesus, Paul himself is a prisoner, whatever. Paul is very deliberate about every single thing he says. And at the end of the letter, Paul describes some people that are with him. And I believe when we look at who is with Paul, we see where Paul gets so much of his great strength. Notice it, starting in 23, he says, Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends greetings to you, and so does Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, Luke, my fellow workers, the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Paul has surrounded himself with people that are actually of great encouragement to him, and they're the kind of people that you and I, if we want to be confident despite our confinement, we need to have around us, or that we oftentimes will find around us. Let's just have roll call here, okay? Let's just have roll call. First, Paul has Epaphras. Epaphras was someone that was known by Philemon, and we know the reason that he was known by Philemon is because the way that he is mentioned here, he was originally from Colossae. And so he's probably part of the church that Philemon is worshiping at. And so when Paul says that Epaphras sends his greetings to you, he's basically, Epaphras is affirming what Paul is saying about Onesimus. He's validating what Paul is saying about Onesimus being useful now. And so we have this person. Paul describes him here not as a prisoner of the state, but rather as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. So Paul, even though he's confined with someone that is very dear to Philemon, and someone that is very dear to Onesimus as well. Then we have Epaphras says, our fellow in Christ Jesus sends greetings. So does Mark. Mark is referred to as John Mark. He wrote the second gospel. Paul and John Mark. Mark wrote the gospel, obviously, after his name. If you know the book of Acts, you know that Paul and Mark had a dispute. They had a In fact, it was so bad that Paul refused to take Mark on the missionary journey with him. Paul has returned from missionary journey. In the previous journey, apparently Mark had become ill or homesick or whatever, but wasn't able to continue. Paul's ready to go on a new missionary journey. Mark wants to go. Paul says, no, you deserted me before. You're not going with me now. So much so that Paul and Barnabas, who traveled together, they broke up into two parties for no other reason than Paul did not want Mark to go with him. When Paul writes his letter to Timothy, he says, get Mark. Get John Mark. Because he's useful to me. Paul is writing this letter with someone that was very useful, that had a falling out, but now Paul has embraced again. It lets me know that the people we need in our corner when we're confined are people that know what it's like to have second chances and to take advantage of those. And Paul writes here with Aristarchus. Aristarchus, we see here. We also see him in the letter written to the church at Colossae. We see him in Acts chapter 19. We see him as someone that likewise was on the road to being a prisoner in Rome. In fact, MacArthur and others would say that Aristarchus was actually martyred and was imprisoned in Rome, and it was actually martyred for the gospel. You know who else is in Paul's corner when he's in prison? He's confined with someone just as committed as he is. someone that eventually is going to give his life for the gospel. Finally, Paul is there, Paul is there with Demas. Here, Demas is spoken of well, but remember I mentioned the letter written to Timothy earlier, saying how Mark was useful, but the letter written to Timothy says something about Demas, and it says that Demas has fled Paul because he had, the scripture says, because he was in love with the world. So Pastor Jason, how does that encourage me? How does that make me feel better knowing that Demas deserted Paul? Well, it is a reminder that you and I have two types of friends. We have seasonal friends and we have lifetime friends. And if we get those two messed up, if we try to make someone a lifetime friend that is just simply a seasonal friend, we're giving our loyalty to someone that isn't returning it. And if we treat our lifetime friends as if they're friends just for a season, then we're going to miss out on a lifetime of friendship because we simply thought that was only for a season. There are people that God is going to bring in your life. Imagine like a subway map. There are times that the trains come together, but they only come together and they're parallel for a short time before the trains begin to go on different routes. There are people that God will bring into your life to encourage you and to strengthen you during a season. But when that season is over, God may lead them or may lead you in a different direction. And that doesn't mean that the friend wasn't valuable at the time. It just meant that it was a seasonal friend, not a lifetime friend. In fact, truth be told, most of our friends are seasonal friends, aren't they? They're friends that we have during a season of our life, but when we talk about our lifetime friends, usually there's only a handful of them. Here, God used a seasonal friend to encourage Paul in the midst of this. And there's Luke. Luke is what I would call a lifetime friend. Luke wrote the third gospel. He wrote Acts. He is imprisoned with Paul. And even at the end of his letter to Timothy, it says only Luke is with him. We have all different kinds of people with us when we're confined. We have people around us that are willing to suffer with us. We have people around us that have been forgiven by God and us. And we've been forgiven by God and others as well. We have people around us that are willing to suffer as much as we're willing to suffer. We have people around us oftentimes that are only here for a season. Sometimes we have people around us that will be around us to the very end. And recognizing that each one plays a specific role, and allowing them to play that role and not expecting them to play some other role gives us great confidence in the midst of all that. One commentator writes, Brogdon writes, about Paul's confidence. And he says there's two reasons that Paul had great confidence. The first reason Paul had great confidence is he knew the character of Philemon. He knew the kind of person Philemon was. He knew Philemon as someone that would go above and beyond and do everything that he trusted in the character of Philemon. But more than that, Paul had great confidence because he knew of the power of God. He knew that God was going to work through the prayers of Philemon. He knew that the God that gives him the grace here in verse 25, the grace of God. He knew that God was doing something much bigger than he could ever imagine. And so Paul is able to plead for the freedom of Onesimus. Notice Paul is not pleading for his own freedom. He's pleading for the freedom of Onesimus because he knows that eternally he's been given his freedom, but he also knows that God is going to grant it for him in this time as well. And so we look over this book. We notice a healthy culture. When we look over this book, we notice that that Paul seeks to influence instead of intimidate. We notice that the gospel, that the fact that Jesus lived a sinless life, died the death that you and I should have died, that is applied to every area of life and to every person we come in contact with. And that we can face the future with great confidence. We face this future with confidence, expecting the best of others, anticipating the presence of others, and appreciating the contributions of others. Father, we thank you for this letter that that not only speaks of the liberation of Onesimus, but reminds us of our own and how we must and how we not only must, but we get to grant that same liberation to others. Father, we pray that you will speak to us and that you'll encourage us. We ask all this in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. I want to thank you for being with us again today. We're looking forward to seeing you next week. We're going to begin a series called Joining God and His Work, how God works and how God invites us to participate in what He does. I want to let you know that you can find out more about Hope Church by going to our website, www.hopeindayton.org. While you're there, you can give up your tithes, your gifts, your offerings. You can also do so through the Hope in Dayton app. And of course, you can use the text to give option. And you, if you're in the Dayton area, we'd love to see you on a Sunday morning. So whether it's on campus in Dayton on a Sunday morning or whether it's online, basically anytime, great to have you with us. We're so thankful for you, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Until then, Lord bless. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. Oh, I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. You unravel me with a melody, and you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies until all my fears are gone. And I'm no child of God.
child.